Dutch audiovisual architect and developer Tariq Bahri.
I was born in Netherlands. My father, who's from Sudan, who spoke Arabic, he got a job in Saudi Arabia. So when I was 5, we moved to Saudi Arabia and lived there until I was 10 years old. That led to a lot of interesting developmental experiences, I'm sure. But one of them was also that I was quite bored, had not so many social contacts, but we did have a MSX computer, which allowed me to basically play computer games. But sometimes when the cassette tapes wouldn't load properly, you know, in the old days you had cassette tapes, you had to load a program, wait for 30 minutes, and then you had a shitty computer game that you could play. Sometimes that wouldn't really work, and then it would just stop, and you would read break at line 160, and you would see a little bit of computer code. And I thought that was really interesting, because the computer was saying something to me in its own language. There was something going on, I started typing a little bit, and I noticed there was some kind of thing that the computer could give back to me, some little bits of text or error messages, which I didn't even recognize as such. Then at some point, when I was like 15, 16, I got into making computer music. I switched my studies, went into music and technology, and from there on I realized at some point that hey, actually this programming thing that I did way back in the day actually makes sense to incorporate with this music making stuff that I'm doing. Also, of course, the study actually gave some pretty decent emphasis on these possibilities by teaching me a little bit of C programming and a little bit of Max MSP. So I could really just start experimenting with that. But when I saw that within Max MSP it's also possible to make real-time moving visuals with Jitter, then I really got very excited, because all of a sudden I had visions of Altecker video clips and Aphex Twin video clips where things were very tightly and beautifully synced. I had them in my mind and thought, like, wow, if you can actually start programming such things in you know, your own way, that would be really amazing. And that's basically how I got into making visuals, which is also what I'm now very much mainly known as. This was when I first set out to make something that would work audiovisually, and I had very little ideas of what was possible, but I did know that my laptop had a webcam and that I could record my own face. And then I just made recordings of just my face making several movements, and I just chopped up this recording into my mouth parts, my left eye, my right eye, and just by making one little recording like that, I could just individually control all the, you know, parts of my face. I connected to all of these movements of the parts of my face to different tracks in Ableton, and then this came out. Because the visuals were reacting in real time, it wasn't just a rendering process after which I would see the result. It was really as real time as the music. I was, you know, composing, and I was seeing my face moving to that, and I could just loop different parts and go back to the beginning. And every little detail I would change in the sound would also be a detail that would change within the visuals. I thought that was a really interesting way of composing. In any case, whatever you get through other senses when you're interacting with music influences how your brain relates to it. So here I made the matrix sequencer. This was my first attempt at making a different type of sequencer. And yes, 3D. because 3D is exceptionally easy to make. Like, for me, that was like, whoa, what's this? That's like super impressive for me at that time. But the way that the graphics card works, actually, everything almost already is 3D. You just need to take it out. But I was very much already going thinking on to the next step. So I went on to make a three-dimensional evolution of this sequencer, which initially I just called Systeem, but in the end ended up to be the software that I'm still working with and still developing. Here is the perspective of the virtual camera into the virtual three-dimensional world that I created. And here is a little map in 2D of my virtual camera, which is this red dot. Here around it, you have all these spheres, which are these things which are floating around the camera. And each one of these creates their own sounds, which is being heard as the camera flies past them. So once the camera is close to an object, or close to several objects, you will hear the sound of these, the combined sounds of these objects. I created a possibility to actually also, to live record audio and video within Versum to, at a spot, create audiovisual compositions with just also an actual human providing the input. So it's not so much anymore this completely insulated audiovisual world, but it becomes this, a little bit more open towards humanity. For this, I'll show this. This is a composition that I performed together with Lea Fabricant, who's a lady sitting over there. She's the singer in this thing, where she was just the basically recording every loop by herself in front of the camera with a microphone. And my role was much more relaxed in a sense than normal, because all I had to do was fly through the things that she was creating. Now I want to focus for just a little bit on the purely visual things that I later did with my software. What I want to do right now is just show how from within the same software, where you can have shapes floating around in 3D space, I'll have just one square which is floating around in 3D space, and the virtual camera is just pointed directly at it. First, the software needs to actually start up. Now, this is specifically going to be an example in visual feedback, which is, I just have one square, that's what I'm working with. This is basically one visual effect. It's just you're taking the last thing, and the visual effect is you're making it a little bit smaller. You can also, of course, make it a little bit smaller and rotate it. Then you get this. And just by adding one little effect of simple rotation, you get something that already is quite complex-ish. And then, of course, because we're not talking about an actual TV in a TV in a TV, you can also not have it be smaller. You can also just play around more with the types of effects that you're going to apply. So things become a little bit more crazy than that. And the great thing about all of this is that I'm basically letting the computer do almost nothing, but just because of the fact that it does almost nothing, on top of almost nothing, on top of almost nothing for so many times, it becomes a very, very complex thing. Yeah, so feedback in the end does just result in really strange, surprising, lively, organic things, which I use a lot these days when I'm making visuals for other people. And tonight, if you're gonna show up at AVisions, you're gonna see some of that. I think that's the end of my talk. Yeah.